الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد عن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال لما كان يوم حنين آثر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ناسا في القسمة فأعطى الأقرع بن حابس 100 من الإبل وأعطى عيينة بن حصن مثل ذلك وأعطى ناسا من أشراف العرب وآثرهم يومئذ في القسمة فقال رجل والله إن هذه قسمة ما عدل فيها وما أريد فيها وجه الله فقلت والله لأخبرن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأتيته فأخبرته بما قال فتغير وجهه كأنها كان كالصرف ثم قال فمن يعدل إذا لم يعدل الله ورسوله ثم قال يرحم الله موسى قد أذي بأكثر من هذا فصبر فقلت لا جرم لا أرفع إليه بعدها حديثا متفق عليه. سيدنا عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه says when it was the day of Hunain, Ghazwatu Hunain, the battle of Hunain, one of those battles that are mentioned by the name in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, لَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَوَاطِنَ كَثِيرَةً وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنَ. Verily Allah has helped you in many places, on many occasions, as well as on the day of Hunain. And this battle, Hunain, is also known as the Ghazwatu Ta'if. Ta'if, the city that is close to Makkah al-Mukarramah. And nowadays, it is one of the miqat, one of the muwaqit of the Hajj, when people, mainly those who travel from Riyadh to Medina, for those who travel from Riyadh to Makkah al-Mukarramah for Umrah or Hajj, they make the ihram from a ta'if. That is the miqat. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conquered Makkah al-Mukarramah on the way back to Medina al-Munawwara, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided to go through ta'if. And there was a battle. Obviously, we do not have time to go into the details of that. But on that day, there were the companions, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, they were in large number compared to what they had in Ghazwatu Badr, in the very first and the early battles, Ghazwatu Badr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the mention of this in the Quran, لَقَدْ نَصَرُكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَوَاطِنَا كَثِيرًا وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنَ إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ. Allah has helped you in many occasions, including the day of Hunain. إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ, when your great number has amazed you and you were admired by your great number because you were in large number. And then initially there was some kind of defeat for the Muslims, but eventually they overtook, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted a large amount of booty and spoils of the battle to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam obtained large amount of camels and the goat and also dirham and dinar, gold, silver, a great amount of wealth. So the Islamic ruling with regards to the booty is that, or that is called as ghanima wa anfal, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the ruling of this in the Quran, in Surah Al-Anfal, yas'alunaka an al-anfal, qul al-anfalu lillahi wa rasul, and also the very first ayah of the 10th juz, wa'alamu anna ma ghanimtum min shay, fa anna lillahi khumusa, walil rasul, walidil qurba, wal yatama, wal masakin. So the ruling is that the leader of the Muslim, he has the authority to distribute those spoils of the battle and the booty amongst the mujahideen, amongst the Muslims, as he befits, as he seems appropriate. So the authority is with the leader. Obviously, in this case, the leader was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started distributing those animals, those camel and goat, and also dirham and dinar amongst the people. And there were certain people who had accepted Islam newly, just a few days or a few weeks ago. And particularly some of them, they accepted Islam when Makkah al-Mukarramah was conquered. Because they came into Islam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled his promise when Allah dhul jalal ikram said, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. Remember, when the help and the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to you and you see people entering into the religion of Allah dhul jalal ikram in large numbers, then فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. Then you must glorify with the praise of Allah dhul jalal ikram and seek his forgiveness. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had seen some people entering in large number, tribe after tribe, entering into the religion of Islam, including many large tribes of the Ta'if, the very city where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was harmed, and he was and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was expelled from Ta'if, from this city, a few years ago, when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Makkah al-Mukarramah, when he came to Ta'if to give them the da'wah to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he started distributing the wealth amongst the people, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave Aqra' bin Habis, this individual with the name of Aqra' bin Habis, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him 100 camels. 100 camels that time was as you have 100 cars nowadays. 100, just imagine. Very large amount of wealth. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him, this one individual, 100 camels. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also gave another individual with the name of Uyayna bin Hisn, he gave him also 100 camels. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them, obviously he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them this wealth in order to strengthen and enhance their relationship and their connection with the religion of Allah dhul jalal al-ikram. And these people, they were the heads and they were the chiefs of their tribes. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them so that they can distribute that wealth amongst their people, so that whole tribe stays connected to the religion of Allah dhul jalal al-ikram. And this is something that is required. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given al-mu'allafati qulubuhum, one specific category of those who deserve zakat. There are 8 types of people who deserve zakat, and one of them are al-mu'allafati qulubuhum, those who are newly converted to Islam, and even those who have not accepted Islam yet, but they are very close and they are inclined towards accepting. Someone who says that I'm studying, I'm sincerely trying to find the truth, I'm studying the Quran, and Islam makes sense to me, he hasn't taken the Shahada yet. Then in this case, it is fine for you. And especially living in this country, in this society, it is the duty of the Muslims, all of us, those who pay zakah, then we should spare a portion of our zakah for these type of people. Al-mu'allafati qulubuhum. Because naturally, when you are helped by someone through money or wealth, then your heart inclines towards him. And you are doing this for good cause, for good purpose. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given these people their right in zakah. Even if they do not suffer from financial problem. Someone who is financially okay, he's good. Someone, say for example, someone who has his own business and is a rich person, it is still permissible for you to spend your zakah on him in order to draw his heart and his intention towards the religion of Islam. So this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And especially for those who are newly converted to Islam, it is our duty to look after them and socially, financially help them, morally help them in learning their religion. If they still have, and many of them, they still have, i.e. although they have taken the Shahada, they still have many misconceptions, many doubts. So it is our duty to stay connected with them. Alhamdulillah, in this masjid, we have provision for such people. For revert brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we have specific department called Islam Wise. So if you, brother, know anyone who has newly converted to Islam, encourage them to stay connected with this department, where we provide, alhamdulillah, education classes, and we give them tarbiyah. And if any one of them requires any financial help, we try our best to help them through zakat funds. And this, alhamdulillah, masjid's policy, that we try our best to spend zakat locally. So anyway, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of his wisdom that Allah dhul jalal ikram gave him, as Allah has mentioned in the Quran in many places, that يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah who teaches people not only the book of Allah, rather he teaches them wisdom as well. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the teacher of wisdom. He teaches wisdom. Just imagine how wise would he be, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of his wisdom, he decided to give these people a large amount of wealth, a large number of camels. He gave 100 to Aqra bin Habis. He gave another 100 to Huyayna bin Hisn. They were people amongst the Muslims. أشراف العرب وأعطى ناسا من أشراف العرب وآثرهم يومئذ في قسمة. Along with these two individuals, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also gave, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also favored some other people who were seen as Ashraf or the honorable people amongst the Arab. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam favored them. And he favored them over his companions, over Ansar, over Muhajirun. Amongst those Muslims, there was a person who said, Wallahi inna hadhihi qismatun ma'udila fiha. And some narrations say that this person was a munafiq. He was a hypocrite. Those who used to partake in the battles with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the intention of gaining the wealth, to have their share in the booty of the battle. That's all. So when he saw that the Prophet ﷺ has given these people a large amount of camels and dirham and dinar, he said, Wallahi hadihi, inna hadihi qismatun ma'udila fiha. By Allah, this is a kind of distribution that I cannot see any justice in this. وَمَا أُرِيدَ بِهَا وَمَا أُرِيدَ فِيهَا وَجْهُ اللَّهِ And I believe that by this distribution, Allah's pleasure is not sought. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. This is something if a Muslim says about Rasulullah sallam that he's not just, he's not fair, and he's not fearing Allah, and he's not seeking the pleasure of Allah, this would be seen as kalimatul kufr. It can take a person out of all of Islam. You think about Rasulullah sallam, he's not just. But this hypocrite, he said. One of the narrations say that this individual, he was the head of the Khawarij. Obviously, that time, there were no Khawarij. But when he said this, some of the companions, they described him. They said, this person was bald head, and he had long beard, and he had black skin, and he had mark on his shoulder. He stood up out of arrogance. He said, Ya Muhammad, ittaqillah wa adil fil nas. He said, O Muhammad, fear Allah and do justice amongst people. So arrogant, kind of insulting and disrespecting Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam within his companion. And obviously, you could imagine amongst them was Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala, who was always ready to defend Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah's religion. He took his sword. He said, O Messenger of Allah, please allow me to chop his head. What he's saying? He's disrespecting you, insulting you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, No, O Umar, leave. Hold on. Then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I do not do justice, who is going to do, who's going to establish justice on this earth, on this land? And then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pointed to that person. He said, he is the one from whose progeny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring a people who will be reading Quran very nicely. They will recite Quran. And he even told his companion, he said, when these people would offer salah, you people, you my companion, you will belittle your salah as compared to their salah. And they will be worshipping Allah, they will be reading Quran, but the Quran will not go below their throat. It will remain within their mouth and tongue. That's a beautiful voice, very beautiful recitation, but they will have no iman in their hearts. And he said, يَمْرُقُونَ مِنَ الدِّينِ كَمَا يَمْرُقُ السَّهْمُ مِنَ الرَّمِيَّةِ. These people will go out of fold of Islam. They will leave the religion as if you throw the arrow in order to hunt an animal, the arrow passes through the belly of the animal. The same way these people will enter into Islam and they leave Islam. And this is exactly what happened. Exactly this is what happened. This was the prediction of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what happened during the time of Ali radiyallahu ta'ala. And those who were with Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, they called themselves Shi'atu Ali, Ali's group, the group of Ali. And obviously there were some battles that took place between Ali and Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhumah. And at one point, Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu tried to make peace. He tried to make peace with Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And when he gave a battle against Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, some of the people within the group of Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, they had extreme mentality. They had extremism in their mentality, in their mindset. They said, Oh Ali, how come you have given up fighting and battle against Muawiyah, the one who is a tyrant, and they had declared Muawiyah as kafir, na'udhu billahi min dhalik. They said, you have given up, and you are now fighting against them, so we are not going to help you anymore. We are not going to stay in your group anymore. And then, obviously, if we were to study history, we find there were battles then started. There were battles between Ali and this particular group, the Khawarij. And then there was a particular battle between Ali radiyallahu ta'ala and the Khawarij, and Ali radiyallahu ta'ala and who killed the head of Khawarij. And those who took part in that battle, they said, we saw that very individual being killed and martyred, and he was killed by Ali radiyallahu ta'ala, and he was the same person who had insulted Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he had other people who followed him in the same mentality. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. And amongst the Khawarij was Abdurrahman ibn Muljim. Abdurrahman ibn Muljim amongst the Khawarij, the one who martyred Ali radiyallahu ta'ala, because he had declared Ali as a kafir. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. So this is the extremism. If you do not treat it right at the beginning, it can lead you to next level. And you can declare anyone and everyone kafir. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. So this is what exactly this person said. But that is another narration. In this narration, this is another individual. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala says, when this person said, he did not say right in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, he expressed his feeling amongst the companion. He said, Wallahi adi qismatun ma'udila fiha. By Allah, I believe this is the distribution that the justice has not been established here. And I don't think Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has so the pleasure of Allah by this distribution. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, one of the oldest companions of Rasulullah, he was hurt by this. He said, Wallahi la ukhbiranna Rasulullah. By Allah, I'm going to inform Rasulullah about the statement of this individual. And then he says, Ataytuhu fa akhbartu. I came to Messenger of Allah and I informed him. When Rasulullah heard this, taghayyara wajhuhu hatta kana kasirf. The color of his face changed to the level that Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu ta'ala says, it became like a red iron and metal. And this was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever he would get angry, his face would become red. And some of the companions say it would become very red, and red like the blood. And in this particular hadith, Abdullah al-Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala says his face became red like the red iron, hot iron. And then he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَمَنْ يَعْدِلْ إِذَا لَمْ يَعْدِلِ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُ. Who is going to establish justice if Allah and His Messenger are not going to do justice? And then he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, and this is the point, and this is the reason because of which Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah has quoted this hadith in this chapter, having patience. He, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, يَرْحَمُ اللَّهُ مُوسَى قَدْ أُوذِيَ بِأَكْثَرَ مِنْ هَذَا فَصَبَرْ. May Allah have mercy on my brother Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, who was distressed and who was harmed a lot more than this. But he had patience. He had patience. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this in the Quran. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, la takunu kalladhina adaw Musa. Do not become like those who hurt Musa alayhi salam, those who harmed Musa alayhi salam. فَبَرَّأَهُ اللَّهُ مِمَّا قَالُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala freed him from all the slanders, all the accusations that they put on Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. وَكَانَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَجِيهًا. He was beloved to Allah dhul jalal ikram. But these people harmed him, they hurt him. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, doesn't matter. My brother Musa, he was harmed and he was distressed a lot more than this. What do we learn from this hadith? Same as what we mentioned last week. When you try to practice the religion of Allah dhul jalal ikram, people will mock you. People will make fun of you. But you, as a true believer, you have to have patience. Follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, you establish your 5 daily prayers, but at the end of the day, you are a human being. You may commit a mistake. When people spot a mistake in you and they highlight and they say, look at this person. Every day he goes to the masjid, he has grown the beard, he's establishing salah, he's seen very righteous and pious, and look what he did. If the same mistake is done by someone who is not practicing, no one bothers. No one pay any attention. But if a practicing Muslim, yes, it is true that practicing Muslims, they must be more careful. And when it comes to the practice of religion, the practice is not only establishing 5 daily prayers and also growing the beard, no. And wearing the niqab and hijab, no. It is the full religion of Islam, as Allah said, "Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa." You must enter into the fold of Islam completely. From head to toe, your full body must be within the religion of Islam. But again, at the end of the day, we are all humans. We all commit mistakes. We do commit sins. Someone who started practicing the religion of Allah, it does not mean that they have turned an angel and they are not going to commit any sin. But those who have hatred against Islam, against the religion of Allah, and particularly against the practicing Muslims, they find this an opportunity to criticize Islam and to criticize Muslims. But for you, again, although you have committed mistake, must repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have patience. Don't become like those who are criticizing you. Because if you do the same, then there will be no difference between you and them. There will be no difference between those who practice the religion of Allah and those who do not practice the religion of Allah. Those who do not follow the sunnah and those who do follow the sunnah of Rasulullah, there must be a difference. So this is what we learn from this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The next hadith is the hadith of Anas radiyallahu ta'ala, who says, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا أراد الله بعبده خيرا عجل له العقوبة في الدنيا. And Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah has compiled all these ahadith, not any in any specific order or according to any particular topic or subject, within this chapter, within sabr. Remember, right at the beginning, we said sabr is of different types. You have to have sabr and patience when you are criticized or you are mocked because of practicing the religion of Allah Dhul Jalal Ikram. And sometime you are afflicted by calamities, then you have to have sabr. You face a problem and hardship and difficulty, you have to have sabr. And for this, we must bear in mind this hadith of Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says that Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِعَبْدِهِ خَيْرًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for his slave, عَجَّلَ لَهُ الْعُقُوبَةَ فِي الدُّنْيَا, he dhul jalal ikram hastens towards the punishment of his slave in this dunya. When Allah loves, Allah intends good for you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes you in this dunya. This is the love of Allah for you. Why? Because as Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا عَذَابُ الْآخِرَةِ أَكْبَرُ. The punishment of the hereafter is severe. It's a lot more strong. It's stronger than the punishment of this dunya. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرُ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Allah says, we make these people taste the punishment, the lesser punishment of this dunya, دون العذاب الأكبر, before the greater punishment of the hereafter, لعلهم يرجعون, so that people can turn and they can come back to the religion of Allah. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided to punish you because of your sins, and remember, ما أصابكم من مصيبة فبما كسبت أيديكم. Allah has said, whenever you are afflicted by any calamity, any hardship, it is because of the earning of your own hands. Whether you realize or you don't realize, you acknowledge or you do not acknowledge, whether you remember or you have forgotten, you commit a sin, then you forget. And this is what happens most of the time. We utter something, we do not pay attention, but it is a sin. We do something that is classed as sin in the religion of Allah, but we do not realize, we do not know. It is the mercy of Allah that He, Dhul Jalal Ikram, pardons and He forgives most of the sins without punishing us. Ya'fu an kathir. That is why He, Dhul Jalal Ikram, out of His mercy has legislated wudu for us, salah for us, fasting. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when a person makes wudu, the sins of when he washes his hands, the sins of his hands are dropped and wiped out. When the person washes his face, the sins of his mouth, his eyes, his nose are dropped. And when the person washes his feet, the sins of his feet are dropped out. They are wiped out. And then you come to the masjid, you offer your salah, your sins that you had committed between previous salah and the current salah, all of those sins are forgiven. On a regular basis, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the means, and out of His mercy, He has legislated these acts of worship for us so that He continuously forgives our sins. But sometimes there are severe sins and major sins that we commit. We do not either repent to Allah or we forget. Then again, it is the mercy of Allah and it is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us that He dhul jalal wal ikram intends good for us in this dunya, and He puts us in trials and tribulation and tests, and He puts us in hardships and difficulties. He said, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِعَبْدِهِ خَيْرًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for His slave, عَجَّلَ لَهُ الْعُقُوبَةَ فِي الدُّنْيَا, He hastens towards the punishment for him in this dunya. وَإِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِعَبْدِهِ الشَّرَّ. On the other hand, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends evil for His slave, أَمْسَكَ عَنْهُ بِذَنْبِهِ, He withholds from him because of his sins. He continues committing sins and Allah does not punish him. And this becomes a great fitna. It becomes a great fitna for those who are weak in their iman, when they see people around them not practicing their religion, not abiding by the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they seem very happy, they have no problem, no hardship, no difficulty in their life. Whereas you offer your 5 daily prayers, you have problem after problem, difficulty after difficulty. This is the point where shaitan takes an opportunity to whisper in your mind, and shaitan tries to even weaken in your iman. How come? And then shaitan whisper in your mind. Where's the justice? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. How come that person is not practicing the religion? And it sometimes happens to you as someone who never practiced religion. You did not pray. You were not regular in your 5 daily prayers. You had very happy life. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided for you to start practicing the religion. You start offering your 5 daily prayers. You try to read Quran on a daily basis. And you try to do in the morning and evening adhkar. You try to practice the religion of Allah as much as possible. But as soon as you start practicing, you start facing problems. And then shaitan says, look, when I was not practicing religion, I was totally happy. I had none of these problems. As soon as I started praying, offering my 5 daily prayers, I have fallen ill. I feel this problem, I face this problem, this issue, this calamity, this difficulty. Then, in reality, this is an opportunity for shaitan to weaken your iman. Shaitan wants you to drag you away from the religion of Allah Dhul Jalal Ikram. But you, as a believer, you must stay firm and steadfast. Have patience and bear in mind, you have spent past 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, not practicing the religion of Allah. Allah Dhul Jalal Ikram did not punish you. And now you have come to the religion of Allah. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. And because of his love for you, he has decided to punish you for your previous sins in this dunya. This is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you must be happy. You must be thankful to Allah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to purify you in this dunya because of your previous sins. Do you want to continue having the luxury and happy life without facing any problem? How is going to be difference between your previous life and this current life? The life when you did not practice religion, rather you committed all sorts of haram. And now you have given up all sins, and you are trying to give up all sins. And you are practicing the religion of Allah. How is it going to be the difference? This is how the difference is established through the mercy and out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah said, وَإِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِعَبْدِهِ الشَّرْ أَمْسَكَ عَنْهُ بِذَنْبِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends evil for his slave, he withholds. Despite his committing sin, he is not punishing him. حَتَّى يُوَافِيَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Until he will punish him fully on the day of judgment. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min adhabi jahannam. O Allah, we seek your refuge and your protection from the punishment of the hellfire. We do not ask you, Allah, to punish in this dunya. Rather, we say, Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-afwa wal-afiyah. O Allah, we need your forgiveness. O Allah, forgive us without punishing us. But if you decide to punish in this dunya, we stay firm. And we have patience. And we say, Alhamdulillah. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also said, Inna idhama al-jazai ma'a idhama al-bala. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, the magnitude of the reward goes along with the magnitude of the trial and the hardships. The bigger trial and test you face, the greater reward you receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna عِظَمَ الْجَزَاءِ مَا عِظَمِ الْبَلَىٰ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِذَا حَبَّ قَوْمًا إِبْتَلَاهُمْ. And verily, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves certain people, he puts them in trials and tribulations. And then through those trials and tribulations, مَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَىٰ. Whoever is pleased with Allah, in times of hardships and difficulties. Yes, when you enjoy the blessings of Allah, you have no problem in your life, it is easy to say, yes, I'm pleased with Allah. The real test is when you are afflicted by a calamity and you are going through a difficult time and you say, I'm still pleased with Allah. And in times of hardships and difficulty, when you say, I'm pleased with Allah, then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Man radiya falahu rida. Whoever is pleased with Allah in times of hardships and difficulties, then for him is the pleasure of Allah. Allah is pleased with him. وَمَنْ سَخِطَ فَلَهُ السَّخَطَ. And whoever is displeased with Allah in times of hardships and difficulties, then the displeasure of Allah is for him. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. So that is why we need to stay firm and steadfast in times of trials and tribulations. No matter how great and big the trial and tribulation or the calamity is, it is not going to last for centuries. Rather, it is going to last for few days, few weeks, months, or even years. But the next life is eternal life, endless. If you stay firm and steadfast, you will have the pleasure of Allah. You have comfort in your grave, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with you. But if you moan, if you complain about the decree of Allah, and you lose patience, and you stop practicing the religion of Allah, following the whispers of shaitan, following your desires, then you may enjoy the life of this dunya for a short period of time, for a few weeks or months or years, but then نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. The next life is going to be hard for you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us firmness and steadfastness in the religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from all kinds of calamities and hardships. And we ask Allah dhul jalal ikram that He subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish us in this dunya, neither in the hereafter. And if we are afflicted by any calamity and hardship, we again have to seek the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He showers His mercy upon us and He gives us tawfiq and ability to remain patient, so that He, Dhul Jalal Ikram, is pleased with us and we are successful in his sight in this dunya as well as in the hereafter. Innahu sami'un qareeb mujib. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.